Welcome viewers, I'm Mamta, PGT Psychology. Let's continue with chapter 1, class 12. Today we'll be doing three topics: psychometric approach to intelligence, then we'll be continuing to intelligence individual differences in nature nurture theory, moving on to assessment of intelligence. Let's start with the first topic. Now, psychometric approach basically means measuring various psychological variables. Now, a lot of psychologists have given different number of variables through which they measure the different components of intelligence. We have six theories under it given by six different psychologists. First theory, unifactor theory. Now, this theory was the first primary theory given by Alfred Binet, who started with intelligence testing also. Now, he just said that intelligence comprises of only one factor of intelligence. That one factor is responsible for all kinds of tasks. So, you take up any task and performance on all kinds of tasks is required by this kind of ability. This ability is used in all tasks. That is one similar set of abilities. Second theory, which was a modification of Binet's theory, was given by Charles Spearman. Now, this is a two-factor theory. Binet talked about only G factor, that was a general factor. The other is a specific factor, which is, for instance, we talked about aptitude. If I'm talking about musical ability, that's a special ability. It is required for a particular kind of task, a specific task. Whereas, if I'm doing speaking or if I'm doing writing, it's a general ability. So, we have G factor, general, given by Binet, all kinds of tasks, whereas specific ability talks about a particular specialization, a particular field in which the person is exceptionally good. That was about Charles Spearman. We move on to the third theory. This theory says that intelligence comprises of seven factors. This was given by Lewis Thurston, and this is primary mental abilities, which are seven in number. In fact, Spearman's theory, the S factor, and Thurston's theory was the basic foundation for aptitude testing, which we'll be studying later. Now, this talked about seven abilities, which are verbal, numerical, spatial, perceptual, word fluency, memory, and reasoning. All of these were measured separately in aptitude testing, in career assessment, that is. Verbal, as the name suggests, speaking part, words, communication, language. Numerical, dealing with maths and numbers. Spatial, dealing with organization of figures and pictures in a particular space. So, talking about this, architectural ability is a spatial ability. 3D is a spatial ability. Perceptual is understanding about, giving meaning, understanding concepts, ideas, my interpretation about things, the way I look at things. Then word fluency, only dealing with the number of words and the quality of words, how fluent you are in using the different combination of words in language. Memory, again, that's simple, talking about the kind of remembrance and storage. If I read up something, I can remember it, that is memory. Reasoning, of course, talks about different kinds of logic, use of logic in different situations. That was about Thurston's theory. Fourth is hierarchical model given by Jensen. Now, Arthur Jensen talked about two levels in the hierarchy. Level one is associative learning, which basically says that you are associating two concepts and remembering it. For instance, children who remember by mugging up, children who remember by rote learning, that is known as associative learning, where you're not using any kind of remembering or meaning. You're just remembering information, not relating it, putting into memory just by repeating it, that is all. Level two is cognitive learning. Cognitive is using higher level mental processes. You are not just blindly repeating and remembering, you're also trying to remember it related to previous information already stored in memory, trying to relate it to different examples, practical life, and therefore, chances of forgetting is very, very difficult in this stage, which is cognitive learning. It's a very effective learning, as the name suggests. Next is structure of intellect model, given by J.P. Guilford. He says there are three major aspects to it: operations, content, and product. Now, he has talked about three different kinds of intelligence, wherein he is given in, it's like a cube model he is given with three major sides, and each side has six, five or six components each. When we multiply them, we get 180 cubes in total. So imagine he gave 180 components of intelligence. So let's look at the three components. Operations, what the respondent does, that is operating on something, which is basically talking about any kind of problem solving, any kind of thinking, any kind of memory, any kind of decision making, operating on the environment by using something, some mental process. Content is basically the nature of information. Now, nature of information can be verbal, it can be auditory, which you can hear, it can be semantic, which is meaning related. So any stimulus or any information which is coming into my brain, that is what is analyzed. Multiplying these two and combining these two, we get the last one, which is product, the form in which information is processed. So suppose we talk about a system in which we are trying to understand everything, or a transformation in which we are trying to understand everything, that is the product which we get. This is the multiple intelligence theory, the last theory of psychometric approach given by Howard Gardner. Very, very important from the exam point of view, comes for a 4 or a 6 marker. Now, this was basically Howard Gardner, a very famous psychologist who was in India lately in January 2012 for his workshops. So the term multiple intelligence has become very famous and very practically useful as well. Multiple intelligence basically says that there are 8 different kinds of intelligence, independent abilities which are there. These independent abilities are very useful from the career point of view. So if a particular child has a certain ability, we can develop that and help him take up that particular career. That is why it's very important. Let's look at the components. Linguistic ability, language based, communication based. So obviously poets, writers, public speakers, debaters will definitely have very good linguistic ability. Logico-mathematical ability, dealing with maths, dealing with numbers, dealing with logic, dealing with scientific ability. So obviously we talk about Nobel Prize winners, we talk about mathematicians, we talk about scientists. Third, spatial ability, dealing with visualization of objects in my mind. I am not, as an architect, varying things. I'm putting the design on paper in my mind and then executing it. So 3D again in my mind and then executing it. That is spatial ability. So visualizing objects in my mind, rotating space. Fourth is musical ability. People who have this ability can understand, sense, perceive music, compositions. They are very sensitive to musical tones and pitch. So obviously various music directors, people who are poets, people who are lyricists, they are good with musical ability. Bodily kinesthetic, this means body balance, body movement, body posture, body coordination. Kinesthesis means movement. So dancers, choreographers, surgeons, they are very good with the bodily kinesthetic ability. Interpersonal is dealing with people. So interpersonal will be counselors, social workers, politicians, very good with other people, handling them, understanding them. Intrapersonal, within the person. So very good for philosophers who are dealing with their own thoughts, their own aspects. Last is the naturalistic ability. Naturalistic, dealing with the nature, the flora, the fauna. So botanist, tourist, all these people are very good. Farmers are very good with a naturalistic ability. That is about psychometric approach. A lot of psychological tests have been developed for this approach. Let's move on to the next topic. Nature versus nurture theory. Now, this theory has three parts. When we talk about nature as a component, we say that we are born with certain ability. I'm born with an eye color, I'm born with an intelligence. Now, it is fixed, it cannot be changed. But yes, the level that has been fixed can be achieved if I'm given the right environment, if I'm given the right situations. A child born in a poor family has a very good intelligence level, but he doesn't get the infrastructure. So therefore, his intelligence doesn't develop because he doesn't get the environmental support. So nature is what you get, the inheritance, the genetic endowment, whereas nurture is what you get in your environment, socio-emotional environment. So let's look at that. Now, in fact, a lot of psychologists have debated that is nature more important or is nurture more important? Is it contributing, is nature important to 60% for a certain psychological variable? Is nurture important to the rest 40%? So they have been debating on the number. But let's understand both are equally important. Let's look at the data here for nature. Identical twins which are born from the same fertilized ovum reared together when they are brought up together. So nature, that is genetic, is 100% same here. And when they are brought up together, 90% of the time their intelligence correlates. Again, identical twins reared in different environments where you see that twins separate due to some reason, brought up in different families. So adoptive parents, they are giving different environment to both the twins. 72% is the percentage of the correlation for intelligence to correlate. Fraternal twins, twins which are born from different fertilized ovum but born at the same time, when they are brought up together, 60% is their intelligence correlation. Siblings, when you talk about sisters and brothers, when they are reared apart, the correlation comes out to be 25%. Now, twins reared apart, as they grow in age, their intelligence level tends to be more closer to their adoptive parents. Now, children from disadvantaged families, this comes as a part of the nurture or the environment, where you have different environmental setup. Therefore, it could be like going to a school, it could be a computer for a simple child, it could be games for a simple child. All these infrastructure developments, if they are not there for a child, they will not be able to reach to the limit that the nature has set for them. Last topic for today is assessment. Here we look at the IQ range and the classification looking at the table. Now, we have a classification which is average. 50% of people lie in this category of IQ, 90 to 110. 90 to 110 is the average category, 50% people lie here. Then next, when we move on higher or lower, it is always plus 10. So we move on to 110 to 120, lower one will be 80 to 89. So we have lower average and we have high average. Similarly, plus 10 and minus 10 will be gifted children, 120 to 130 and then 130 above. And then lower one will have 70 to 79, which is borderline. So again, percentages are given for this. Last point here, when we talk about mental age, chronological age and IQ. Mental age as a term was given by Alfred Binet. Mental age basically means how much intellectual development is there as per the age. So intelligence tests developed by Binet measured the mental age. William Stern later added on to the concept of mental age upon chronological age in 200, giving the concept of IQ. So when obviously the mental age is same as chronological age, mental age you get by the test, psychological test, intelligence test. CA is what you are having, the particular age you are having. So MA upon CA into 100, if MA and CA is equal, then your average IQ comes into picture. If a child who is having an age of 5 years, but can do the items which are meant for a child of 10 years, obviously here his IQ is much higher. So to summarize, today we covered the psychometric approach, which had 6 approaches under it given by different psychologists. Then we covered intelligence, the variations in terms of the hereditary component and the environment component, the nature-nurture controversy. And thereafter we studied the assessment of intelligence, in which we tried to understand how is IQ measured and how is intelligence distributed in the normal population. That's about it for today. Thank you.